which is fine, but often it can also be just, you know, to impress others. You know, I'm a great musician or something like that. You know, one can sometimes we want to impress others just by becoming initiated and giving a spiritual name. And sometimes we have someone, you know, just giving themselves a spiritual name and think that other devotees are impressed by that. I didn't try to stop, you know, new devotees from this giving themselves names and like that. It's like, you know, how can you impress anyone? It's like you award yourself the title of, you know, to be initiated devotee. It's a certain recognition there, you know, you've been recognized, you're sincere, at least started practicing on the, you know, on the level of 16 rounds and 4 related principles and dedicated to a guru like that. So it's kind of a little recognition. So, but if one just, you know, assumes titles himself, if I called myself a professor, PhD, and just called myself like that, who would be impressed by that? I said it's a joke. So we shouldn't, you know. Or we can, sometimes it's, devotees get into all the external trappings of a devotee, extra, you know, extra big neck beads, extra big tilak marks, extra big
sika.
Extra big sika, or so many external symptoms. Really maha big japa mala with a, like tennis balls. And making big declarations and saying the right things and Prabhupada ki jai, preaching ki jai and so on, and all the things that, you know, one gets recognized for in Vaishnava society. I mean, it should be the real thing. We should become the real thing. I mean, imitation doesn't. The point is, imitation doesn't bring us anything. It's cheating, and the point is, if we try to cheat, then Krishna, he is the best cheater, and he will also cheat us. That we have to understand, that Krishna, he reciprocates. So if our approach to Krishna is cheating, and we want something cheap, rewards, fame, profit, distinction, or position, facility, or whatever, then Krishna, he will also cheat us. He will also cheat us. Guru will also, even Guru will cheat us. Krishna, he's a king of cheaters. It's I think I mentioned that before, in the 10:35 Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna says, among cheats, I'm gambling, isn't it? Is that 10:35? It should be something like that, isn't it? But there actually, Prabhupada, he added to the manuscript, it was found some years ago, in the Bhagavad Gita manuscripts, it was Prabhupada, he in the purport, he actually added a line. Det er bare more imitation.
Pretend.
This is just looks fantastic. You know, here we are, you know, big microphone, like, you know, addressing the Royal Albert Hall at the yearly, you know, worldwide international. So Prabhupada, he actually added in the Ja.
1036,
yeah. So probably he added a sentence on the manuscripts that actually for many years never were in the Bhagavad Gita, but we got in our Bhagavad Gita actually. Probably he had a sentence where he says that he says, I don't know exactly, but Prabhupada writes that Krishna is a can be okay. Yeah. Yeah, it says here. Okay, I'll translate back into English. There are many kinds of cheaters all over the universe. Amongst all forms of cheating, gambling is number one and therefore represents Krishna. And then this sentence was what Prabhupada he had added. The unfortunate commentator who wants to cheat Krishna and the public by claiming that there is something that is greater than Krishna is himself cheated by Krishna and cannot understand him at any point in time. That was really a nice sentence. So you know so the commentator tries to cheat Krishna and he's cheated. And the cheated is he cannot understand Krishna. That's how Krishna cheats him. He thinks he's a great commentator, and Krishna cheats him. He doesn't understand anything. And similarly, we may try to cheat Krishna, and want something external, something like that. And Krishna will cheat us. We'll not cheat him. Maybe we'll get something fruit of game or something like that, which is so easy to get. Krishna, he says in Bhagavad Gita, that quickly, of course, men achieve the results and the fruit of activities. It's we think it's so rare, to become wealthy or powerful or famous or like that. It's so easy to get. Krishna says he's creating so quickly, and but the real thing, the relationship with Krishna. And that cannot be gotten by any kind of one and any kind of external motives. There is also in the Bhagavatam, fantastic purport where also Prabhupada he talks about that what it takes to be empowered to actually spread Krishna consciousness all over the world. And how is it? Prabhupada talks about, clearly talks about himself and his god brothers. He doesn't mention names, but it's about himself and his god brothers. And he talks about that sometimes disciples, they want to enjoy the property of the spiritual master. And of course, it's obvious what Prabhupada is referring to, his spiritual master, Bhaktivinoda Saraswati, constructing big temples and they're made nice rooms, you can have an office and you can have a position there. And then that is their goal, to have a nice comfortable position in the mats in the temple. And Prabhupada writes, and the guru being merciful may also give that to the disciple. But he will not give him the potency to actually preach Krishna consciousness all over the world. That potency to preach is only given to the disciple who has no other shelter except the lotus feet of the guru. Is that how he writes?
Sounds quite accurate.
Yeah. I think it's in the sixth canto, somewhere in the sixth canto. You know that, Tejasvi?
Bhagavad Gita expert. It sounds familiar, but I don't know where it's from.
It's actually really, really careful about that. It's striking, so striking. There's one has to have no other position and no other ambition except that you want to serve the spiritual master. Then one can get the potency. But if it's something else, basically something material, some comfortable position or some recognition like that, yeah. So that's also available, but actually it's not. It's just in that case, it's a devotional service. You know, one doesn't get the relationship with Krishna. It's just another way of maintaining a comfortable material existence. It's just a devotional service becomes a job, like it's a nice job, a nice facility, but a job basically. Like everyone else, they go to their jobs, make some money so they can pay and have their house and so on. So someone discovers that actually the best facility one gets by performing devotional service and being with devotees and like that. And then, so if one function at that level, well, that might one might also get one's desires fulfilled on that level, but one will not get potency to preach, spread Krishna consciousness to others, and actually experience the higher, the actual, not even the higher, but the actual, level of Krishna consciousness, with where one act, establishes his personal relationship with Krishna, with the personality of Godhead, will not happen. We have to be, the message, at least what I saw here is, again, this message is, no pretension, we just have to be, be ourselves, and, be what we are, and sincerely try to, serve our Guru, serve Krishna. There's no substitute for that. Krishna is only achieved by sincerity, by the real thing, and we cannot cheat Krishna. So, I'll stop here.
It's quite interesting that Krishna, he might. The person who wants to be cheated, Krishna, he will facilitate it. He will give him some material substitute.
Yeah.
Huh? Because that's what he wants. Krishna, he sees in his heart, that's what he wants.
Yeah.
So being a pretender, that it becomes very difficult to change the character there, because Krishna, he is seeing your nature, so he goes along with it, and then. But I often find myself in a situation where I want to cheat people to take a book, and I just want to give them a quick mantra and take a book, And Krishna, he might go along with that for a little while, But I become really. That's when I become angry and frustrated, when he doesn't go along with it. And he shows me that I have to change something in the course. And it's such a relief just to speak about God and how you can have a loving relationship with God. And that's, it becomes so, there's so much.
Taste when we generally out there to actually benefit people who pray to Krishna, please use to benefit that person, because can't go on the street and just see others as objects for something I want to suck up from them. It's so boring. But that's what goes on most of the time. Mm. I speak of myself, and I'm not. No, but if I really wanted to help, help people, if that was a dominant desire, something more would happen than that. 100 bhagavatas would fly out a day. Krishna would. And there's nothing, 100 bhagavatas a day is not much.
But then you know, you do all the books and we wouldn't be able to do any books according to
Thailand.
Super
so,
so Krishna, he's very merciful to us because he, by not allowing you to do what you actually have the humility to do, then, you know, he allows us to also do something. It's like when I'm with Navina, you know, he does 1,000 books and I do 10. You know, like, Krishna, he's not so merciful there.
So actually, until the Navina song, he must have quite a strong desire to actually benefit people.
Yeah, he was, now he was, if I can comment on that, because he was in, he was doing the Bhakti Vaibhava course for 3 months, just sitting learning slokas, you know. And all the while we knew, you know, Rishikesh event is coming up, you know. So he was like, he exploded, you know. It was like really fireworks.
Because it was interesting to see him, because actually when you see him on some level, you know, he's very aggressive. Somewhat even manipulating, different manipulating the people and
and really tricky and
someone might say that he, is, he must be into it for himself and it's, you know, he's very passionate and all that, but cannot be, it's not possible.
He knows all the, he's very intelligent. From like Vaisheshika, he put it like this. He said that Navina is, this is Vaisheshika speaking, he said that Navina is the most street smart person he knows.
Yeah.
And that's coming from Vaisheshika, that's something.
Yeah.
So he is that, he's really street smart. He just knows all the psychology, all the moves and all the, he's been around the world, he speaks all the countries, or all the languages, you know, he's been everywhere, you know. People say something to him and then he just, he speaks back in their language. He was there just like 5 minutes ago, you know, like, so like, and from that, just from that, and then he has that very strong desire to please Krishna. He never rests, he just works really hard and he's not, he doesn't go out on the street, it's not like, oh, he goes out on the street and he's like a volcano, he's like a tornado, you know, and he doesn't stop. He just, you know, he goes out and even when it's time to stop, you know, he keeps going, you know. He doesn't stop, you know. And when he has no more books, he comes and he takes my books and he distributes them. He just, like, you can't get in his way. It's like impossible. He's very strong desire, you know. He has so much faith in book distribution.
So why is he empowered and some of them are not empowered? But it's clear, you know, he is much more, you know, there's no extra motives or, you know, otherwise Krishna wouldn't give him that.
I think
it's basically, for, you know, going on for so all these years. Someone can come for a shooting star for a short while and like that. But going on like that, and even for a while I've been away and then back again, it's a...
Wonderful to see. I also thought that you mentioned... I mean it's kind of the test of book distribution. That is like the that if you want to be sincere, then book distribution is a day to day. You know, you go out and you feel, you actually test. Okay, what did my consciousness? Where did it lead me to? From doing what I was doing, what did it lead me to? And then you go out and you test. You know, how is it? How is that cultivation going on? And then you get a, immediately you get a response from Krishna.
I was wondering about this imitation versus just having honest material desires. Because we see in Bhagavatam, for example, Dhruva Maharaj, who approaches Krishna for something material, and so he's not in that way like cheating Krishna, because he's quite honest about what he wants.
Mm, yeah, and he comes to Krishna correctly, and then he's purified by the deity, and then he gives up his material desires.
My question was just, I heard in the same way in a class by Navinaneta Prabhu, that he came to Krishna consciousness looking at the book distributors, and his desire was, I want to be the best of them.
Yeah.
And then he just started like working on his game and building up an arsenal, learning what he could from the others, dropping that which didn't work, and like adapting.
Yeah.
So that was in a way personal motivation, but seems to get purified over time just by sticking to it.
Yeah, that's what happens. I mean, but that's not pretension as such. So, it's because if you associate with Krishna even for something external, you become purified. That is the example of a thief who wants to steal Krishna's ornaments. And you know the story.
So
Krishna is first, he's just Krishna as a child, and he's decorated with all kinds of jewels and ornaments by his mother, and the thief somehow gets him, to a place where he's alone with him, and then he starts saying, can I have your jewels and like that, and Krishna says, no, my mother will get angry with me if I give them to you, I cannot. And then they keep on. Then finally, one month, Chris said, "Oh, you can. Yes, you can take him." But at that time, he's purified. Says, "No, he doesn't want to. He changes." So that's what happens when when we approach. But again, the thief there was not pretending. I mean, he honestly wanted to. Pretending is something else. It's making an external show to a mundane audience, for a mundane audience, that one is a more advanced spiritualist than one actually is. And that is one doesn't get purified by it. One actually just becomes, that's a hypocrites there. And this is being ignored. And can just stay in their position for lifetimes. Unless if they are nobody, this Brahmana who was beaten by the snake charmer, afterwards. I mean, of course, anyone can wake up, I can also, one can be a hypocrite at one point, just start facing oneself, actually be a little introspective, say, I'm just a hypocrite, give up maybe. But this, it's really considered one of the lowest is pretending to be something spiritual, which one is not. Prabhupada writes in the Bhagavad Gita that an honest street sweeper is far superior to the child's meditator, who simply meditates to make a living. Isn't it like that? Right? So, what was the question? Was that?
It was kind of vague question, but I just wanted to hear some elaboration about the difference between pretending and then like coming with personal motivation can be done.
So there, Dhruva doesn't pretend to be a great spiritual actor. He's very honest about, I'm just I just want this. And but it's, you know, you pretend to be something you're not, to just to achieve some cheap prestige. And this is what you're talking about.
Small comment. Association with more advanced devotees really help.
Mm.
Because, I mean, sadhu sangha is, that is the solution,
yeah,
because they will point out to you. If someone's isolated, then you can think that you're...
Yeah, from the grace.
Mm. But Dhruva Maharaj didn't even have that association, but still. Of course, he got Narada Muni's association,
yeah,
but I mean, he was still kind of very sincere.
Mm.
He wouldn't have given up for anything. I remembered my comment, and that is, in order to be sincere, I discovered that distributing Bhagavad Gita and having a desire to, you know, maintaining a desire to do a number of Bhagavad Gitas, I find that very helpful.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's like you want to bless someone. You want, and I have that desire when I go out, you know, I want to bless someone with the Bhagavad Gita. At any cost, you know, and because it's a different thing, you know, a big book like that is different than a small, because the small books you can go up to people and la 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 la, you know, la 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 la. With Bhagavad Gita you have, there's some stronger desire, sincerity must be there, so I find that helpful and wonderful to see them walk away with the Bhagavad Gita.
I think we must stop here. Thank you very much.
Now I can do this.
No, it is recording.
Yeah.
I have to focus. Zoom.
Yeah.